Hello, I'm Jonny Smith from The Late Break Show.
I'm Richard Porter from Sniff Petrol.
And you might know us better as Smith and Sniff.
One of the things you can see this weekend at Goodwood is the Bonhams auction, which is happening here. A lot of tasty treats for sale, starting with this.
Yeah, it's a big tent here. We've got a few cars to get into, but before we get into the real cars, this is brilliant. An officially licensed product. I remember these in the 80s. They were exceptionally expensive then, and they're even more collectible now. It's got an engine in the back. It's rear-wheel drive.
Not a flat six.
No, it's a Honda single-cylinder lawnmower derived. But what a beautiful thing. And actually, looking at the price, £3,000 to £5,000. You could actually buy a real Porsche for that money.
Boxster, yes.
Not a very good Boxster.
Yeah, not a bad
average Boxster. But I love them, and always have.
Let's have a look what else we've got. There's an ejector seat over there, if you want an interesting chair for your home. It's from an F4 Phantom, but certainly a talking point. But there are cars, lots of cars.
I think we should start with the car that you actually can't buy this weekend, which is a bit of a carrot dangler, but we can't walk past a Lotus Carlton without a moment to worship, I find. Are you in agreement of that?
Yeah. I suppose, for people of a certain age particularly, kind of an iconic car. A big talking point at the time, the fastest saloon car, I think, that had ever been at that point.
Yeah.
And it was so quick that questions were raised in the House of Commons. One MP said it shouldn't be available for public consumption. He believed it was dangerous. Now, what's funny is it has 377 horsepower.
Yeah.
You can buy a VW Golf with 320 these days. It sort of sounds quite modest, but at the time, it was practically seen as deranged.
Yeah. It's one of the few cars properly mentioned in Parliament, I would have thought, as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, nice Bentley Mulliner coupe there. But what I wanted to talk about, actually, was this Ogle.
Oh, the Ogle. Let's have an Ogle over the Ogle. No one's ever said that, I bet. Look at this is the best angle, I think. It's the strange little behind.
Mm.
So it's effectively, Ogle made a load of very odd things.
Yes, well, they were a design company. You could almost regard them in their day as a sort of, you know, equivalent of a British Pininfarina or Bertone or something. But the things they designed were maybe a little more modest. They did a lot of buses and things like that. But they also, for people of a certain age, designed the Rally Chopper. So they
Which
have
I
got
didn't
an
know
icon
until
in their back catalogue.
I didn't know that until about half an hour ago.
This, though, is a Mini underneath, or it uses the subframes and the engine of a Mini with a fiberglass shell, which I think is quite cute.
Yeah, come around the front. Come around
it's
the front.
It's a nice little thing, but you can see here you've got your Crossways A Series engine, like in a Mini. The estimate on this is £30,000 to £40,000, so it's from 1962. Yeah. That's getting close to what good Minis go for in that sort of era. So, you know, you're effectively getting three Mini bits with a nice, cute little fiberglass bubble.
I remember seeing this about 10 years ago in the Stile Lux, and it's been since converted into a race car. I think it's phenomenal. It's odd, but I really like it. Look how small its wheels are. It's so underwheeled. It's comically underwheeled, but I like it.
This is nice. However, can I interest you in a BMW sponsored by a porn mag?
Of course.
Step this way.
Of course. Of course.
635 CSI.
It's selling the top flat. That's what it's, isn't it?
It's so.
Look at this.
This was an official BMW project to make a racer out of the 6 Series back in its day, but the engine was by Alpina. The whole thing was built by Schnitzer.
Yeah.
This has been restored, and when they restored it, it campaigned in Italy originally. When they restored it, they sought out the original livery, which includes, you might notice, a sponsorship by Penthouse, the classic top shelf pamphlet for gentlemen, and it's got various other nice decals and things on it.
It is I actually think, because I was looking at the reserve, what is it, like 140 to 180?
It's 140 to 180, but it's FIA compliant. You can race this now, so.
Yeah. And it's a full.
Say cheap at the price. Maybe so.
It's a full motorsport chassis.
Yeah.
It's a real race car, and I think this era of race cars are on the fly at the moment. Mm. I would like to play with this. Is this the Vanguard?
The Vanguard, yeah. The only reason I mention this is because if you look at the pictures of this, you'll notice that the driver sits so low that, in fact, the person driving it for their official photos can't seemingly see over the wheel like a child. It's a nice thing if you like that sort of stuff. I'm sort of more interested in this over here. It's an old Aston Martin. It's very lovely. It's one
built
of the
in
Oscar
New Zealand.
India ones. so named because they used the NATO alphabet. It was codenamed OI for October introduction because they were going to bring it out in October. And then the head of the company was a keen pilot. He decided to switch that to the NATO alphabet, Oscar India. They're just nice. I think they're nice. You're not so keen, I believe.
These?
Yeah.
Do you know the ones I don't like? Is as soon as you introduce plastic alongside chrome, I have an inherent problem with that.
Yeah.
It's either a chrome car or a plastic body kit car. It can't be both.
I know you like that.
Yeah, I do like the Bug Eye. I've always been a fan of the Bug Eye Impreza.
Imprezas,
yeah.
Many believe should be blue.
Group
gold
A.
Wheels. Knock yourself out. Fantastic. But this obviously is proper Group A car.
2002, yeah.
80 to 100,000 pounds. To live out sort of cut price Colin McRae fantasies, but probably worth it.
And change to right-hand drive from left-hand drive, which is great unless you're about to buy this car and you live in America, or Germany,
France. We could go on, but there are lots of countries to drive on the other side.
But that's...
I'm gonna trot down here to
Testa Clay Rossa, yeah. I do actually like those as well.
I don't because I've driven one.
Oh, okay.
And the two things are linked very much.
Oh, okay.
Although I do sort of like the way they look. But anyway,
I like the way that the side profile is, is good.
Yeah, no, there's an elegance to them, I'll give you that. But this, like a lot of Ferraris, they're kind of, when they're new, they're very fashionable and everybody likes them, and then they become sort of dated looking.
Yeah.
And that happened to these. It's the most 80s sort of design feature of any car in history.
They
became a little snobbish about them, didn't they?
You know those faded photographs in barbershop windows of how your hair could look?
Yeah.
It became one of them.
Yes.
But I think it's come out the other side in a really good way. And I know someone that bought one of these about a year ago.
Yeah.
And they said it's the best sports car they've ever bought. Wow. They think it's easy to live with, it's genuinely fun to drive, and it's not a nightmare to look after.
Well, I think quite a misunderstood car as well, because Ferrari's intention with it was always to make a GT car, not to make an out-and-out supercar.
Yeah.
To not take on the Countach head-to-head, although at the time everyone assumed that was its purpose. But to make it comfortable, to give it big boots for a mid-engine car so that you could go touring in it.
Yeah.
And once you kind of get your head around that and you go, oh yeah, it's supposed to be comfy and it's roomy and it's got space to put stuff for a car of this type, you go, oh yes, it actually makes a lot of sense. I think these are great. And this,
it's also an engine layout.
80 to 100,000 pounds.
So it's done 24,000 miles and I don't think they'll ever repeat that engine style.
I think
is anyone ever going to repeat a flat 12?
Flat 12, no. We're sort of running out of time, but I've got to just go and look at this, because if you remember your grandmother's bathroom in the 70s, well,
my parents
have a car
bathroom
the car
right
of.
Now, actually, genuinely. And I know all the better for it.
These, but they're just wonderful, these.
The colour scheme's quite
V8,
Aldo.
3.5, fabulous.
So it's the V8 one. I think it's an American import, because looking at the reflectors.
Drive. Oh, yes, you're right.
I'm going to gander at the catalogue.
You could pry those off with a screwdriver or just leave them. They're not that bad. It is a delightful car. I just mainly like the colour, but the rest of it is wonderful too. Late model 911 Turbo, if you fancy it. The last year of production, these are quite rare, relatively speaking.
Yeah.
Classic, get some braces on, and you can live out your 80s fantasies.
I would do that with the smaller one. It does fit adults, that small one.
What else? Lotus Elite. Now, Lotus has been in the news this week because they've announced a new Emira, their new little sports car. But it's not little compared to that, which you could tuck in your pocket.
Do you know what? That looks so tiny next to the 80s.
It looks tiny next to everything. Look, it looks tiny next to my shoe. It's a fabulous... I don't think I'd fit in it, but I love it.
No.
The same.
I like the roof.
They're sweet, aren't they?
But I can't walk past these. I think the last time we did one of these auctions at Speed Week last year, me and Rich chatted about a Maserati Ghibli. This is a Ghibli SS, and it's right-hand drive. I just think they're one of the coolest looking.
Yeah.
All bonnet. No messing around. It's just so handsome. What is
now,
it? 160 to 200,000. I can't afford it.
Do you like a Z8?
Yeah, see, BMW Z8, Bond film, Piers Brosnan. I nearly said Piers Morgan era. Not Piers Morgan, James Bond. Definitely Piers Brosnan. I didn't like these at all when they first came out.
No.
I didn't understand them.
No.
The wheels I still don't like because it's that era of soft line alloys, which I think they're sort of a non-committal alloy wheel.
But the thing about these is that they were sort of regarded in their day as being not very good, and yet they've always been quite valuable. The top end of the estimate on this is £180,000.
Is it?
But they've never been in that realm where they've seemed sort of unloved. And it's odd because usually a car that's regarded as not great to drive, I'm sure they're perfectly nice. Actually.
I think the face has got better with age. The face has, not sure about the back door. But I like the face. The face is better than I remember.
We're going to have to start wrapping this
it's
up.
It's a busy lunchtime.
It's a busy old place.
But let's skip the lunch area. Because over here, there's something I want to talk about. I want to talk about the AC Ace.
Oh, yes.
You always see Shelby AC Cobras on the track at the Goodwood Revival. They're infamous. But this is the car that it was always based on. You know, the AC Ace, it's like the slimmer, less steroidy brother of the AC Cobra. And you just don't see them very often. And this one I noticed. It's been in the same owner for 55 years. It's only done 800 miles since it was restored in 2007, so it's basically not been used at all.
And it's got a straight six, Bristol straight six. But you look under this in the engine bay, and you can see where Carroll Shelby got the idea to drop a V8 in, because it is roomy in there with this six in it. So you can see why he suddenly thought...
Carroll Shelby thought this was the starter motor, and he thought the real engine was somewhere over there. And then when he realised it wasn't... But in all honesty, you can see Shelby just... He widened it all. This is actually a really slim... It's a very petite car, but I love it. I love it.
That's pretty much the end of things, but we have got to talk about... This is probably considered the star attraction here. Aston DB5 convertible, not Volante. They didn't start using the Volante name until the DB6 came along. Fact fans. But this was once owned by Peter Sellers.
Yeah.
Which obviously gives it great provenance. But then just to really double down on the provenance, it was sold to Lord Snowdon and his then wife, Princess Margaret. So it has a great deal of provenance. And it's a very pretty car. And the estimate, as you'll see there, is 1.3 to 1.7. million pounds.
But this is my favourite bit. My favourite part of the convertible DB5, this particular car, is this. You think that someone's shoved an aftermarket aerial on in the 80s.
It's a big car phone warehouse, yeah.
But it's not. This car was actually fitted with an old-fashioned telephone, a car phone. It's not in there anymore. I believe some of the wiring is. But I mean, at the time, that was incredible.
Mind-bogglingly futuristic. The whole boot would have probably had to have gubbins in it and maybe an actual phone operator with little wires. But anyway, it's an incredible thing. It's kind of one of the stars, if not the star, of the auction. If cars could talk, I think this one would be told to keep its mouth shut for legal reasons.
I would.